This month, I have had so many questions on introductions. I'm getting, what on earth do I even put into my introduction? How do I keep it concise? How do I make sure it's interesting? How do I attract a reader? And finally, how do I know when to stop once I've started writing? So now we're going to talk about the things you need to know to write that introduction. Welcome to Butler SciComm. I'm Casey Butler, and today we're going through introductions. So on this post on introductions, we're going to talk about three key things. The first is going to be addressing the gap in the field. The second is going to be structuring your introduction like a funnel. And the third is going to be then the key parts that we're going to put into that introduction. So the first thing that we're going to talk about related to introductions is the gap in the field. And so what this gap in the field is it is the hole left by previous research, essentially. So the way that you can find this gap, the way that you can know what yours is by look for something that has been left unanswered from previous work, a recent question maybe that has been brought up by recent work, a major glaring hole in the field, something that has yet been able to be done. Essentially, it was the main thing that your research tried to do, the main question that it tried to address. And so you can find this gap in the field by looking for that main question. And so what you want to do with this gap is you want to open your introduction by telling the reader about the major problem in your field, the major problem that you tried to address overall, actually. And what you will do with this gap is you will use it to highlight two key things in this introduction. The first one is going to be how your work fits into the field overall, because by highlighting the gap, you show how your work fits into this field. The second thing that this is going to highlight is the importance of your work, because by telling the reader what the gap in the field is, you tell them where your work fits, and then you tell them why your work matters and why it is important. And that's a really key thing to convey to a reader, and it's very important to get that in the introduction and as early as possible. So when you are writing your paper, remember to always include the gap in the field. So now we're going to talk about structuring your introduction like a funnel. So what do I mean by that? What I mean is that you want to take the reader from the broadest points that would be most interesting to them, that would be most known to them, teach them the things they need to know to understand the specific details of your research. And so if you were to look at a diagram of the scope of the introduction from the beginning to the end, you will see that at the top of this diagram, the scope is the broadest. That's because this is going to be the stuff that is the most relatable to a general audience. Then as you move down the introduction, the scope narrows. That's because you are focusing what you're talking about, you are focusing your research, you're focusing your terms, and teaching the reader what they need to know to understand the most narrow scope of the paper, which is going to be your work. So in essence, you are writing something initially very broad, very generally accessible to a reader, and then from there, you are teaching them about what currently exists in the field, and narrowing their scope such that they are then able to understand the work that you did in your paper. So finally, we're going to talk about the four paragraphs that you're going to put into your introduction. Starting with the first paragraph of your introduction. If you look at the scope diagram of an introduction, the first paragraph, the top paragraph, is the broadest scope. And that's because this has to be the paragraph that attracts the reader's attention and draws them into the paper and makes them want to read it. So what we're going to put in this first paragraph is the major problem that you sought to address and why the reader should care about that. And so also I say the main problem that you sought to address, but this actually might end up being a bit broader than you ever considered when you were doing your research. Because what you want to do with this paragraph is, again, you want to attract a reader's attention. Oftentimes, the problems that we address are ones that we know as experts in the field. And so what we're addressing is actually a nuance or something much smaller that is not going to be as relatable to a broad audience. So maybe you're addressing something that you know is a gap in the field, But your readers aren't going to necessarily know that because they don't have the same information as you. So what you want to do is you want to find a problem that your readers are going to care about and make this a bigger problem. For example, does your research have an application? Will it eventually have an application? You can talk about that. Like maybe this is a disease detection or a disease treatment option. You can talk about that. Maybe this is going to be something with, you know, affect government, such as water treatment, something that's going to affect policies. And with that, you want to give the reader a problem that they can much more relate to and tell them then why they should care about it. So that's going to be your first paragraph, a broad problem that can attract a reader's attention and telling them why they should care. Again, if you remember back to talking about the gap in the field, everything in this introduction should relate to your gap in the field. So also this paragraph should highlight where the problem still is, where that gap still is that you sought to address in this paper. So the second paragraph of your introduction is going to talk about the field. What is currently going on out there in terms of trying to address this problem? And so what this is going to be the one section of your introduction that might have more than one paragraph. And so what these paragraphs are going to include is discussing what is currently being done. What is out there? What are current best solutions? What are your competitors doing? What are people currently working towards? Also, and just as important, is talking about the field is relating each one of these points still back to that gap in the field. If you don't tell the readers when you're discussing the field where the gap still lies, then it's not obvious why your research is needed or why it's important. So as you're discussing the field, always be relating the information you're giving the reader back to the gap and why it still exists, even though there's this other research that's done in the field. And so that point right there is actually really important for determining the length of your introduction, because this part, this paragraph or a couple paragraphs, is not a full literature review. You do not have to talk about everything that has happened in your field. In fact, you shouldn't talk about everything that has happened in your field. What this paragraph should show is just what is important in the field for the reader to understand your research. And so the way to determine how much information to include is by continuously relating this literature back to the field. If you could always be relating the literature directly back to this gap in the field, then it's probably okay to include in your introduction. If you're finding that you have chunks of this paragraph or paragraphs at all that don't necessarily relate to your introduction, they should probably be cut. Keep this as streamlined and focused as possible. Again, the whole point of this introduction is taking the reader from their broad knowledge level down into the narrow scope that they need to understand your work. So keep this paragraph or paragraphs if you need down to a manageable size by always relating them back to the gap in the field. And then the third paragraph or chunk that we're going to discuss is not necessarily included in every paper. And so what this is going to be is I call the background paragraph or the specific considerations paragraph. And so what I mean by that is I find there's either two things that fall into this category. One, either very specialized techniques from your particular lab that would not be very well known to the field as a whole. As an example, a lot of my postdoc research was done on a very specific type of phage display that even people who were experts in phage display probably didn't really understand. So a lot of our lab papers have one very similar paragraph in this point that just explains the technology that we use. So this is one consideration that would go in this paragraph. The second thing that would go in here is what I call special considerations. So for instance, if you're developing a new methodology, and after you've gone through describing the field and you've narrowed it down to key things or key points that your new technology needs to have to be effective, though, this is where you would list those. So what you would do is you would list maybe your 3 to 5 key things that your technology needs to have, explain to the reader a little bit why this technology needs to have them. And so then when you move on to the next paragraph, the reader is fully aware of why you're doing what you needed to do because you needed to address these points. And so one last thing I want to mention here, yes, If this is specific background techniques related to your lab, it is a bit like the field. The reason that I want this to be its own third separate paragraph is because this is even narrower than the field as a whole, because you're describing specific techniques used in your lab. So by making this a third paragraph down, it just makes sure that you remember to put these techniques that are specific to your lab or your work at the end of the literature review, because your scope is narrowing even further. Okay, so the fourth paragraph and final paragraph of the introduction is the one that most people are familiar with. This is going to be where you talk about your hypothesis and the objectives you had in this research. So now, if you look at our introduction, you started from a very broad scope with the problem as a whole. You taught the reader about the field, bringing them in a bit more about what's been done, maybe some special considerations that they need to have. And so now, when you go to tell the reader your hypothesis and your objectives, the reader is going to just completely understand, or should completely understand, why you did what you did. So if you did your job right in the introduction, you set them up with a problem, taught them what's been done, and then when you explain your hypothesis, they should just think, yeah, perfect, of course they did it like that. That's a very obvious thing that they should have done. And that's what you want. You want it to be obvious why you did what you did, why it matters, how it fits into the field, and why it's important. So everything else that you do in this introduction is setting up for paragraph four. So writing paragraph four, again, this is your hypothesis. This is the major objectives that you had in your research. You can also relate this back into the gap in the field, because your hypothesis should directly address that gap in the field that you've been talking about. And then finally, you can give the reader a very brief indication of if you were successful or not going into the paper, so that they might be a bit more interested to read about what you've been doing. So there's our post on the basics of introduction. I hope that has addressed some of the questions on what to write, how to keep it concise and interesting, and stay tuned for more posts. For more information on this topic specifically, you can go to the blog to read about the post, or you can subscribe to my YouTube channel for more posts in the future. I hope you enjoyed. Thank you for joining us.